The King's Privateer by Dewey Lambdin. Copyright 1992 by Dewey Lambdin. This full-length reading was published by arrangement with the author's agent, Wiser & Wiser, Incorporated, and was produced in 2001 by Books on Tape, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. This book is read by John Lee. Part 1. Go, mount the western winds and cleave the sky. Then with swift descent to Carthage fly. There find the Trojan chief who wastes his days in slothful riot and inglorious ease. Bid him with speed the Tyrian court forsake. With this command the slumbering warrior wake. Aeneid, Book 4, Virgil. Chapter 1. Shortest damned commission in naval history, I'll be bound, Alan Lewrie commented to his dining companions at Gloucester's Hotel and Chop House in Piccadilly. Oh, God, is he on about that one again? The Honourable Peter Rushton, one of his old friends from his brief term at Harrow, almost gagged. Give it a rest, will you, Alan? There's a good fellow. It is a wonder you don't still wear blue exclusively. Can't dine out on your little bit of fame forever, you know, Alan. Clotworthy Chute, Rushton's constant companion, agreed round a bite of steak and sloshed a sip of wine into his mouth to clear his palate to go further. Bloody war's been over nigh on a year, don't you know? You're home, well set up, got oceans a chink to spend, oceans a mutton to bull. What man has need of anything more? Well, it's not exactly oceans of guineas, Clotworthy, Alan pointed out. More like a trickle of yellow boys than a proper shower. But didn't Granny Lewrie just finish visiting? Peter Rushton asked. I'd have thought she'd have refilled your coffers to overflowing. So that's why you two bade me dine with you this evening, Alan said with a leery expression. From the first time he'd met them, neither Rushton nor Chute had had 2 pence to rub together. Chute's parents had gone smash and only provided him a miserly £100 a year. Rushton's papa, Lord George Rushton, Baron of Stourton, had scads of loot and rents, but limited the Honourable Peter to a mere 1,000 guineas a year. It should have been enough for anyone, but young Peter had always spread himself a bit wider than most, and loved the gaming tables a bit too much. Both of them could be downright abstemious with their own funds, but could happily spend some other young fool's money in the twinkling of an eye. "You use me ill as so many bears, sir," Peter shot back as if he had been stung to the uttermost limits of his personal honour, but then gave a sardonic bark of amusement. The thought had crossed my mind. Damn me if it hadn't, Alan. But we'll go equal shares on the reckoning tonight. So there. I believe we're flush, eh, Clotworthy? Flush up to the deckheads, as our Alan would say, Clotworthy agreed, smacking like a contented porker over some recent change in his fortunes. And how was old Granny? Still prosperin'? Nigh on to 70 and spry as a hound, Alan marvelled. And none too fond of my living arrangements, let me tell you. Spent most of my time over at their lodgings getting preached at. Glad my father's off in the country most of the time, too, Rushton commiserated. Leastwise, there's my younger brother, should I have a bad end. Title's safe. Lord. Parents do have such vaunting expectations, don't they, though? Wasn't enough I got through Harrow and Cambridge. Now he wants me to amount to something. I ask you, me, amount to anything? Just let me inherit. And who were those rustics I saw you with on the strand, Alan? Clotworthy teased. New companions? The cousins, damn 'em, Alan winced. I'd hoped no one would know me. Had to take them everywhere, see and do everything, except anywhere near a good tailor or dressmaker. Following fashion is sinful extravagance to their lights. Just about everything back in old Wedden Cross is perfection, to hear them tell it, and everything in London is like a German woodcut engraved hell. Wedden Cross? Wherever the devil's that? Clotworthy asked. Devon, near Exeter. Ah, damn dreary, I should think, Peter Rushton shivered. You'd think right, Alan agreed. His post-war visit had been the most boresome 2 weeks of his life. The Nutbush Cove, his granny had married to transfer the Lewrie estate to his coverture, so his father Sir Hugo couldn't lay hands on it, was a dour old squire, not much taken with him from the first, no matter his repute as a sailor hero, and had made it perfectly clear that Alan should harbour no hopes of getting his sinful little paws on a farthing of the new Nutbush estate. He'd also made it pretty clear that the farther such a rakehell was from his own kith and kin, the better, no matter what his grandmother wished.
"Old Granny still dotes on you, don't she?"
Clotworthy asked further. "He hasn't turned her off you, has he?" Clotworthy was one person Alan would never discuss money with. He'd started out school days a living sponge, just borrowing at first, but had graduated to a higher calling of criminal endeavour lately.
"Aye, she slipped me a little on the sly. Not much, mind,"
Alan lied. Actually, his grandmother had done him rather proud. A purse of banknotes worth 100 extra pounds above his 200 a year remittance. And she'd gone shopping and had outfitted his suite of rooms with a new Turkey carpet, a handsome wine cabinet and desk, and a new set of chairs for his second-hand dining table. She'd also provided a new lockbox for his chocolate, tea, sugar, and coffee, and while strolling with him through one of the Academy exhibits at Ranelagh Gardens, had purchased a nautical painting he'd taken a fancy to, which now hung over his sitting-room fireplace mantel.
"Ah, well," Clotworthy sighed in slight disappointment, knowing he couldn't hit Alan up for a loan, not right then, at any rate.
Alan was surprised Clotworthy Chute had even agreed to go shares on their supper. Usually he lived on someone else's dole, like a Roman client, when he wasn't bamboozling some idiot out of some ready pelf.
"Must have found a new fool to bilk," Alan decided. "They were the most peculiar lot, Peter," Clotworthy said, laughing.
"So, that's at Strand, Cousin Alan,"
Alan mimicked.
"God bless us, it's wide, ain't it? However ye get across street here in London, me dear."
Which caricature set his dining companions off in mirth. "I tried to take them to my usual haunts, but they weren't having any of it. Coffee houses were nests of idleness. They'd be happier in a counting house where people do productive work. Covent Garden, Drury Lane, I do believe, shocked them to their prim souls. Got an hour's rant about sin, fornication, the low morals of theatre people."
"They're right on that score, thank the Lord," Peter said, giggling.
"Lord's cricket grounds, that was acceptable to them. The banks, the palace. The change, you'd have thought, was Westminster Abbey," Alan went on. "Couldn't even get them enthused about a raree show. Suggested watching hanging, thought that'd buck them up, but it was no go."
"Speaking of actresses and such," Peter Rushton sighed, "how does a run over to Will's Coffee House in Covent Garden sound? I feel like putting the leg over some nubile young thing."
"Topping idea, Peter," Clotworthy said in his best toadying style. Evidently, Chute had gulled some other young wastrel earlier, and for once had his own cash to go on a high ramble.
"And just who was it this time, Clotworthy?"
Rushton asked him, much amused by his schoolmate's new trade as a Hooray Harry, one of those Captain Sharps who could decipher to the penny how much someone's inheritance was worth at first sight, and could also discern to the shilling just how much of it he could abscond with in his role of guide amanuensis to the pleasures of London life.
"The Right Honourable Matthew Jermyn, Viscount Mickleton," Clotworthy boasted. "Poor little shit. 20 years old, just down from the country. Rich as Croesus, now he's inherited. Must have led a damn dull life up to now. Like Alan's cousins, he wants to go everywhere and do everything. So far I've shown him a decent tailor. You can't believe how chore bacon he looked when he got down out of his coach. Had suiting, I'd not give a starving Irishman. With a tricorn on his head, don't you know? Ha, ha, ha.
That wouldn't be your own tailor, would it, Clotworthy?"
Alan asked, pouring them all another glass of burgundy and waving for the wine steward to fetch another bottle.
Made the man an easy £300 in an afternoon, with enough overage to pay my bills off, and finagle a new suit for myself out to the bargain. Clotworthy tittered. Oh, we've had some fine times, I tell you. The old family equipage just wouldn't do. So I steered him to a carriage maker of my acquaintance, over to Newmarket for 4 fine horses, new hats at locks, and a brace for me as well. I've got him ensconced in a townhouse.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.